Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing? I have the privilege of introducing our first speaker today, Dr. Burt Folsom. Dr. Folsom has been a college professor at many places, especially Hillsdale College in Michigan, where he still serves as a distinguished fellow. Dr. Folsom received his PhD in history from the University of Pittsburgh, and he appears regularly on Fox News. Dr. Folsom is the longest speaker we've had here at Young America's Foundation. Please welcome Dr. Burt Folsom.
Thanks. Thank you, Caitlin. It's great to be here and to be with such a lively group of people. I've been hearing good reports on you. And when we get the college conference or the high school conference together, the national one here, like we do now, we always get good students. And I wanted to try to get my best talk, something that really help you sink your teeth into a big topic. And what could be bigger than why did the United States become a great economic power? And when? Even when? When and why? Now, you know, I teach history. How many think, yeah, that's kind of a decent history question to be asking, right? In a history class. Why, in American history, why did the United States? Because we were really lowly in the world after our independence. And Great Britain and France and others could just beat up on us if they wanted to. Happily, they didn't want to very often. But we grew, and by World War I, we were the strongest economic power in the world. And so the interesting question is, how did this come about? What went into it? What did we do right? And if we know what we did right, we could adopt some of those ideas to make sure we continue to stay on top, right? So I think this is an important question. I wanted to talk about it with you today. And because we know it happened in the late 1800s, sometime after the Civil War, maybe 40 years or so. And so 1860 to 1900. So it's in a generation. I mean, people born in 1830 or 40 grew up when the United States was lowly. And then if they're 70 or 80, we're on top. So what did they go through? What did they see? What happened in their generation that helped us? Now, I want to start with something that did not happen in their generation, right? It happened in our generation, but it is an American product. And I'm going to get to the origin of this because this has helped a little bit what helped sort of kickstart our growth. You know, we can do so much with this. How many of you, because you've been here a while now, you're here yesterday. How many in the last, since you've been here, have been in touch with somebody 100 or more miles away from here? I wondered if it would be the most of the people in the room. How many maybe over 500 miles away? Wow. How many in another country? A few. Now, see, we look at that is so unusual in a sense. Could, for example, if we were having our conference here 100 years ago, it's 1922. Well, let me ask you this. Could we have communicated with somebody over 100 or maybe even 500 miles away? 1922? I see some going no, some saying yes. Yes. Sure. What do you think?
I think that's a yes to the telegraph.
Yeah. The telegraph. And what else besides telegraph?
The telephone.
Telephone's out by then. Right. So you could definitely. Right. And what's your name again? We met yesterday.
Theo.
Pardon?
Theo.
Theo. Listen, Theo, I want to give you a book. For he answered the question right. You get a prize if you do that. Theo, a signed book, and I want you to have that. And it was, for a while, number one on Amazon, and it's on Franklin Roosevelt and the New Deal. But what the larger point is, you're exactly right, telegraph and telephone, both. You got them both. Now, what about 200 years ago, 1822? We're all here. D.C. is still here, and we're all around, and we're in a room like this, and you've been here a day for a conference, and we're talking, and I'm speaking, and I'm saying, gee, did anybody here, while you're here, get in touch with anybody 100 or maybe 500 miles away? Could, yeah, do you think, no?
No.
No. No, you're right. So, I mean, think about that. You are part of, in a way, a special group in history, because most people in history through most of time have not been able to have that kind of communication. It is absolutely a key part of the modern world, but it was something that was unknown. Now, I suppose if you had smoke signals or, you know, yelling, you could get a mile away or half a mile away or something, but really to get that kind of distance, it really takes some kind of communication. Now, the telegraph is invented in 1844, so we're about 175 years away from that invention right now. So the telegraph is invented. It's an American invention, although other people were playing with it. The idea that behind it is that with the telegraph, because you're communicating with a wire, and you're going to get wire poles on wires that are going to go all around. And the idea here is that you have a wire, and Samuel Morse, who's the inventor of the telegraph, is discovered, and others had been doing this too, that you have a long wire. If you whack on the wire, it sends an impulse up the wire that can go a long distance. And there are ways you can do that to preserve that impulse and keep it going. Now, see, this is human ingenuity here a little bit. You're thinking, gee, if I can do that and it can go miles away, an impulse, if I could get a code of some kind, and Samuel Morse invented, of course, the Morse code. If I can get a code of dots and dashes, I can convey letters and then send a message. And so you have, for example, you'd have the Morse code system. This would be the letter F. Now, the easy letters, the letter E. That exhausts my knowledge of Morse code. I know 2 out of 26 letters. But the point is, if you memorized all that, then you see you tap on the wire, you hit it, bang, then dot, a dot, and then a dash, and dot. Then you have a space in between, and the person there is saying, oh, that's an F, or that's an E, or that's an O, or whatever. And so that idea was what Morse did and developed, and it was such an obviously breakthrough invention. I mean, I don't think we need to say, gee, this is just a minor little invention. This is a great breakthrough invention, the Morse code. And so what we have is he's inventing it, and he's getting, he gets 30,000, the government wants to get involved and helps him set up wire, 40 miles of wire between Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, Maryland. This is the first wiring of the Morse code here in Washington, D.C., right about at the Supreme Court building, all the way to the railroad station in Baltimore. You've got that 40-mile stretch, and we have that. And the ruling on this, I wanted to read from our Postmaster General of the United States, who was in the James K. Polk's cabinet. President Polk was involved in the Morse, in the development of the telegraph. And we're deciding, what do we do with this invention? And he said this: the telegraph, so powerful for good or evil, cannot with safety to the people be left in the hands of private individuals uncontrolled by law. Because, I mean, that's kind of wild. We were a country which we agreed that the government should be there for national defense. I mean, there is a role for the government. National defense, coining money and that kind of thing. So there's a definite role for the federal government, but not in the economy in the founding documents. However, this was so dramatic. I mean, the greatest invention, some said, since the printing press. The implications for communication. That we decided, and Samuel Morse agreed, the government should control it. I want to read that quotation again. This is commonly agreed. The telegraph, so powerful for good or evil, cannot with safety to the people be left in the hands of private individuals. It could be abused, perhaps, by private individuals, not by government, presumably. And by government, see, you'd have it backed and it would be fully funded and that kind of thing. So this is important. So the telegraph will be funded by the government and owned. This is very unusual in American history, but it's such an important invention. That's what we're going to do. Now, you charge for the telegrams that you send. The dots and the dashes, you have offices in Baltimore and an office in Washington, D.C. And there you set up telegraph offices where you have, obviously, people who know the Morse code, the dots and dashes. You have secretaries. You have people coming in to give the messages. You have somebody taking the money, perhaps. You have different people. So you have some employees, obviously. Now, you're going to make money off the telegrams, where people communicate with one another, and you can go, at least for now, 40 miles and get a message immediately across for news from Washington, D.C. or whatever. And so the idea is the government will take it, the government will make money, and because we don't know if we can trust private people, but the government we can trust, we're going to put the government in charge. That's a system in the 1840s that we have. 1845 is going to be the first year the government will control the telegraph. It's going to become an economic concern. The United States is at the center of it. Now, the first year is interesting, where the government owns the telegraph. The employees in Washington, employees in Baltimore. In the first 6 months, if we look at the revenue from the telegraph, revenue coming in, what we find is that the expenses for operating the telegraph office and for repairing telegraph wire as it sometimes is damaged in storms, lightning and that kind of thing, the repair costs for the telegraph and the operating expenses, as we would say, were, if you look at the revenue and look at that, and then you look at the expenses and see which one is higher, the expenses were higher than the revenue by a factor of 6 to 1. That is, if they took $100 in for people paying for telegrams to be sent, and the cost, it's $600 for 100. Now, we were looking into this, so the government's losing money. And this is a time when actually the federal government had balanced the budget. I mean, not only balanced it, we got completely, the founding generation in this country totally paid off the national debt, the expenses of the Revolutionary War and everything by the late 1830s. So we were actually operating with no national debt. And the idea of going into debt to run this telegraph was annoying. But a lot of people said, hey, it's the first 6 months, people don't know about it yet, and they'll learn about it later. And they'll want to send telegrams. So we looked at the revenue at the end of 1 year. There was a somewhat of a change in the second half of the year 1845. There was. The change was this. Instead of being 10 times or 6 times more expense, $6 spent for every $1 gained, it was $10 spent for every $1 gained. In other words, it got worse and we're going into debt. At that point, Cave Johnson and others said, you know what? I think maybe the telegraph could be operated privately. Is that a revelation? Maybe we don't have to have it government owned. Maybe someone else can run this loser. And so we sold it to a guy named Ezra Cornell, who was a carpenter, he was a plow maker, but he also worked on installing the telegraph line. So he knew a lot about telegraph, and he bought that from the government, and it was like, you know, the people in the government, we unloaded this invention on this carpenter. You know, we don't have to go into debt for that anymore. Yeah, private people can run it. Yeah, that's okay. You just go take it. And then they laughed even louder because Ezra Cornell, the first thing he did was he went to the banks, borrowed money, and extended the telegraph from, you know, you've got Washington, D.C. to Baltimore. And then he extended it to Philadelphia and then New York City. So he's borrowing money to make it even longer, once he was in New York City, he quickly advertised, anybody from Washington, D.C. to New York City who wants to know what's happening on the New York Stock Exchange can get a telegram back and forth on your stocks. And they even developed a way to money transfers for wiring, for getting money to do investments, or just to buy or sell anything along that axis from Washington, D.C. to New York, which is a huge part of the American population. Wow. His business is flourishing. Other companies come in and start telegraph companies. Ezra Cornell's company was named Western Union, and it's still around today, although not doing telegraphs, but it's doing other things. Western Union, and then you have other companies coming in. And so now telegraph wire is being extended all around the United States. It even becomes transcontinental. I like drawing a map of the U.S. here. I'm really good on the Canadian border. And then, you know, we go around and here's California and Texas and Florida. And where's Maine? There. There's Maine.
Really taking Alaska out of this.
Here's Alaska. And by Alaska's important because we bought the telegraph was used to help buy Alaska from Russia. A lot of the negotiations in the 1860s were done on telegraph. So yeah, we'll put Alaska therefore on here too. Now, Washington D.C. to New York we'll say is up around here. So now we've got major cities connected. And what happened is people in New York over here, you get people wanting to know what the weather is because you have steamship companies wanting to know what's going on in areas where steamships are coming in South Carolina. You have just general people wanting to know information. Police want to know about crime. You could say a criminal was headed north from Philadelphia to New York, and here's a description of him. And then the cops are waiting for him at New York. And so you get all sorts of ways that you can relay information from one city to another that proves to be helpful. And not, you know, I mentioned the money transfers. It becomes really a financial apparatus here. And as other communities come in, it becomes family oriented because Ezra Cornell at Western Union and others said, hey, it's Mother's Day. Send your mom a telegram to show you care about her. What about her birthday? And then says, hey, your grandkids, you people who have grandparents, they want to know about your grandkids. Send them information through a telegram. And then they had singing telegrams that could convey the information. Oh, can you see the innovation? This becomes one of the great inventions of the 1800s. The telegraph and the ability to communicate. We had, I mentioned, in 1845, we had 40 miles. By 1852, we had 23,000 miles of telegraph wire. Many companies were in the business and they were making profits. Ezra Cornell becomes a multimillionaire and starts Cornell University. Now, this is kind of interesting when you look at this because it was such an incredibly successful industry and the forerunner of modern communication. And so, Mike, I do have a question for you to think about. I want you to think about this for a minute. If a carpenter and a plowmaker like Ezra Cornell can figure out how to take this business and make it into a multi-million dollar business, why couldn't the people in Washington, D.C., why did they lose money? In fact, as you're thinking on that a minute, we even had an overseas telegraph. We went across the country by 1861. That's 15 years after. we're already across the country, so you could do a telegram to somebody in California from New York. But also, we had an under, in the water with protective shield on it, cable laid on the Atlantic Ocean, and we reached England in 1866. We had an operating cable line that worked 20 years after Ezra Cornell got going. And then we could communicate with Great Britain. Now we have foreign exchanges. We can keep track of foreign issues, treaties, all of that. This is a huge business. And the question is, the government had total control for a year, and there were smart people. The people who were operating the telegraph office in DC and in Baltimore were bright people. They'd been to college. They'd done all sorts of things. The people involved in this and setting it up were smart people. They went broke. When it was turned over to free enterprise, they flourished. Why? Yes.
My guess is that the government wants sort of control over everything, and so they thought it was going to be a non-profitable business, and so they just were like, we're not going to invest much into it, and then all that money that was invested into fixing wires and everything, when they should have really expanded, was what made them go broke. But when free enterprise entered the arena,
yeah,
they were like, no, how about we just expand it, and they made more money off of that than what the government would have done.
Yeah, what's your name?
Jasmine.
Jasmine, I have my other book I want to give you. FDR Goes to War. Thank you. This one. And the telegraph ultimately went to war too. But here you go. Thank you. But Jasmine was saying, hey, the government didn't, looked at it kind of not, they didn't see the profit in it. Whereas a private enterprise sees profit. And that's the heart of the answer. But I want you to look even deeper here. If you are a telegraph operator working for the government, you're doing the dots and dashes. You're sitting there at the beginning of something that's a monster business. You don't know it yet, but it has, you can all see the potential that this is, everybody, so that's why we said it has to be owned by the government. You can see the potential. We're doing dots and dashes. The incentive of the person at the telegraph office is not to sit there and say, oh, I need to go down to the bank and borrow huge amounts of money, and let's get this thing expanded to New York so we can get the stock exchange involved. And then I want to deal with money transfer ideas. You're sitting there, I'm being paid to do telegrams. In fact, the fewer people who come in to send a telegram, the better. Now you can read the newspaper, read a book, sleep. You could do anything you want. Oh, no, there's somebody who's coming with a telegram that he wants to send. Darn. I'm going to have to sit there and do the dots and dashes. Oh, it was a long one, too. They charged by the word. You know, this is a long one. Oh, dots and dashes. Now, okay, got it. Okay, goodbye. Oh, now I get my newspaper. In other words, what I'm saying is that you're looking at it always so narrowly. Anybody in business always looks, what can I do to meet needs that people have? And if I can meet people's needs, really, then I can profit. And that's how Ezra Cornell looked at it. The government never looks at a problem that way. It was, as Jasmine was saying, it's sort of non-profit was her word. Well, they kind of non-profit. It's hard for the government to think creatively. It's very impossible. They only can think like a bureaucrat. I want to do my job so I don't get fired. I know I can get my paycheck. It's the government. And then I'll come back, do my job, not think anymore about it, and then leave. So the people working there were bright. They just weren't thinking. They had no incentive. It's an incentive issue. They did not have the incentive to think outside the box and see the possibilities for the telegraph. You needed somebody to come in and say, yeah, I want to make money, but how do I make money? By serving people who, and convince them that they'd rather part with some money to send a message than to keep their money. And so I want to meet a need where they want to give up some money to get a service that I can render. And they're thinking, and Ezra Cornell and others who started companies came up with that. Now, I say this and emphasize this early because what's going to happen is the United States is going to do one more blunder with the transcontinental railroads. We're going to have those funded by the government. The Union Pacific, have some of you in your history classes studied the Union Pacific Railroad? Yeah. And sometimes they people give it a positive treatment. It's the Union Pacific is going to go from Omaha out to California, where the Central Pacific is going to be there. And so they're going to build here, and then they're going to help, and then they're going to meet, and the government's going to pay the mileage. But I want you to notice something. They're paying by the mile. Therefore, the Union Pacific began to take on, I'm exaggerating, but I want you to get the picture. They're paying by the mile. Do you see the problem? The incentives are, oh, they're paying by the mile. Let's get all the miles we can over this flat land in Nebraska. Because we got mountains out there, and then we want to quickly get over those and get into something else. The point is, the incentives are not good for building a sound railroad. The government subsidy made it inefficient, and another railroad operator named James J. Hill out in Minneapolis, in St. Paul, built a railroad, and notice that this one is straight across to Seattle. His railroad, I'll use this for rail, is called the Great Northern Railroad and was, the many people argue, is the most efficiently built railroad in the country because he had a stake in it. He had no federal subsidy. He has no federal subsidy. He makes a profit. The Union Pacific goes bankrupt and it has a government subsidy. And it's like, wow, we're connecting the dots. The telegraph was owned by the government, went broke. The railroad owned by the government or funded by the government, it's foolishly constructed, went broke. This one, no government, it's run well. We were trying to catch up with other countries, Great Britain and France. Yeah, we were trying desperately, and we couldn't do it. And we said, look, we thought maybe we could do it by the government and have the government help. That flopped. We may never catch up with Great Britain. I don't care. A lot of people said, I don't care if we do or not. We are going to turn our entrepreneurs loose. We either catch up or we don't. We turn them loose. And here I've been giving you facts. I want to get into an opinion. The period after the 1860s, after the Civil War, the next 30 years in the rise of the U.S., with this flurry of inventions, I think, just an opinion, is the greatest creative outburst of entrepreneurship and inventions in any 30-year period in the history of the world. That's an opinion. It's argumentative. And I'm going to mention them. And so, you know, we're not doing too bad here in the last 30 years, are we? You know, we're up against something pretty serious. But I'm suggesting that if you look at these inventions, all in the United States, we turned our entrepreneurs loose. The government is not going to be involved except occasionally to pass a protective tariff here and there. But it's no funding. We get the following inventions. The telephone, right? Alexander Graham Bell, the telephone. That really supplements the telegraph now. Now you can talk with someone and not just send a message. How about Thomas Edison? What did he develop? Electricity? Yeah, light bulb. I would say developing electricity is substantial. Another big one. And he also had the phonograph. It was the first time people could hear music and not have the orchestra right there. And I've been reading accounts, you know, as a history person, that there was this one older woman who came from Vienna and they had great orchestras. She migrated over here and then heard some of those on that music on an album, and she was just in tears. So I never thought, you know, I couldn't get back to the home country. I never thought I'd hear it again. The phonograph, movies, film. Yeah. Pretty great just with those inventions by Edison. But let's go on further. We have the typewriter. Historians love the invention of the typewriter. Now we don't have to read handwriting and, oh, this is something typed. I can read that quickly. Yeah. Typewriter. Adding machine. It's hard to believe. Before the 1880s, when the adding machine was developed, all corporate business was done by hand. You add the numbers by hand, and, you know, error could creep in. All the time spent adding columns of figures for a corporation, the adding machine just completely makes work more efficient. Finally, the computer. The computer invented by Herman Hollerith to do the 1890 U.S. Census was a fabulous invention, and he had note cards. It was like note cards. This is where a card is about like this. He'd punch out data like your age in an age group, you know, 10 to 20, 20 to 30. You'd punch out something, your job, and you'd punch out something. What country were you born in? And you had different, and the point is you'd have all that information in the census, and you'd put the card in a machine, and with the adding machine and the typewriter and all of that already being developed, we could put that together, and we did the U.S. Census quickly, and that became the forerunner of IBM and current computer businesses. All that in the United States. The car, the automobile. Henry Ford knew that people wanted a car before they knew it. When you ask people, how would you like to improve travel in your life? They said, oh, faster carriages. More comfortable carriages with better shock absorbers. Get the horses moving more quickly. Henry Ford thought motorized traffic would do it. And he spent all his spare time working on what he called his quadricycle. It had bicycle tires, his first car. I mean, it went real slowly through the streets of Detroit. And for a headlight, he didn't have headlights. At night, he was developing. He'd have somebody holding a lantern out in front of him as the car would come chugging through the streets slowly. But it was the beginning of the automobile. Dramatic. All of this to the United States. We, immigrants coming all over the world to the United States to work in factories, producing these and other products that the United States is producing. The United States becomes the world leader. You would think, with that track record during the late 1800s, free enterprise and private would be really solidified. Now, here's the interesting thing. Right as we begin the 1900s, a movement came to try to have more bigger government. And it really begins in the economic world with the idea of the airplane. Listen to this. See what you think. Here's an argument. We need the government to get involved in the airplane. Ready? Here's why. The airplane is a huge invention. It's transformative, like the telegraph. And Britain and France and Germany are all experimenting with the airplane. And they all are talking about, if we can get an airplane, we're going to fly up in the air, and we're going to come over your country, and we're going to drop something. And it's not going to be confetti right over your country, and you will surrender, and we will dominate you. And the idea was, oh my gosh, is the ocean big enough to protect us if one of those countries gets a bomb, comes over New York City, or over Maine, drops it, boom! And meanwhile, you can see him say, and meanwhile, we have people who are saying, oh yes, let's invent a new development for the adding machine, or let's invent the cheeseburger. Let's invent something. We're sitting there talking about inventing that, and it's cheeseburgers, the last meal of our life, and boom! That's why the government has to get involved, to direct the energy and enterprise airplane. Find the best person in the country, turn them loose, and have them invent the airplane, and then we beat them. We have to get the government involved with a subsidy. What do you think of that argument? Same. You think that's the same argument?
Well, not entirely, but the same argument, I guess, but basic, same.
Yeah. The same concept, maybe? That argument was so scary that the never let a crisis go to waste people had invented a crisis. They're going to invent it and they're going to come over and drop it. Get the government involved. We called in our best aeronautics expert in our country, a man named Samuel Langley. He had written the textbook called Experiments in Aerodynamics. And the reason he was called and was considered an expert is that he had had a kind of a model plane. And he put it, it was like 20 pounds. It wasn't just really light, but it had an engine on it, a small engine. And he was here in D.C. He was head of the Smithsonian Institute. He was considered a great scientist. And he had that engine, and he flew that over the Potomac. And Alexander Graham Bell, who invented the telephone, was saying, wow, this is so incredible. He was there. And he was saying he was actually agreeing that we needed a subsidy. For Langley. Langley came to Washington, D.C. He had honorary degrees from Harvard, Yale, Oxford, Cambridge. He had people who would always, his kind of people who worked for him would follow him, taking notes on what he wanted, say, do this, do that. And he came in and sat down with the Department of War, and they said, do you think you could invent an airplane? And he said, yes, I can. And I am willing to receive a federal subsidy. Isn't that kind? He's willing to receive a federal subsidy. So he does. He gets his federal subsidy. And he says, I want to have a subsidy to do two attempts because it's just possible I might not, the first one might not work. If we were white, he did. He got the subsidies, and he was getting this big engine, and he made this biplane with two parts. And if you were watching it, the thing that you would notice, I think, most is that he was doing it on a houseboat in the middle of the Potomac. And he was going to, there was no runway. He was going to launch it with this catapult device. And the idea is you shoot it in the air with a catapult. The engine comes in and he's got his pilot. His pilot, by the way, interestingly, was a Cornell graduate. He had to be Ivy League for Samuel Langley. And so what he does is he developed this in the day he was going to do it in October 1903, he had a 21-gun salute from the government nearby. Boom, boom, here he comes. And he told his pilots, he says, now, when you get shot up in the air, he had a compass stitched on his pants so he could know which way he was going. And he said, don't stay up more than 10 or 20 minutes because we need to just make your point, swing around, and then come back and you'll land in the water. And he did, but by the way, that last part was exactly right. He came in, the 21-gun salute, the punter, they put it on the catapult on the houseboat in the Potomac. The reporters were around. Boom! It's in the air, that glorious moment. Boosh! Splashes right into the water. In researching this, I thought the newspaper of record is really the Washington Post. And I thought, what's the Washington Post going to say? And the Washington Post said this. Let me get my notes here. 13 words. Any stout boy of 15 could have skimmed an oyster shell much farther. And that was the consensus, is that it was a disaster. But he said, not to worry, I have another attempt. December 7th, 1903, they're in. He said, I'm making some adjustments. He's in the catapult. Boom! In the air. The same pilot, by the way, survived the first one and had to be fished out of the water on the second one. And the plane was just underwater and all this, and it was a disaster. And the papers weren't so kind the second time. For example, the Boston Herald said, Professor Langley ought to give up airplanes and try his hand at submarines. The New York Times said, this is so complicated to put a person into space that it will not be accomplished for 1 million years. That's what the New York Times said. We're still 1 million years away from putting somebody into space. Their estimate was off. Yeah, I didn't see anybody taking notes. They didn't quite hit their target there. It was off by 999,999 years and 356 days. 9 days later, the Wright brothers in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, with less than $2,000 of their own money, launched the first flight. They flew several times that day, one flight being almost a minute, and air travel was born. They experimented to perfect the airplane because they said they wanted to give it to the Defense Department because we need it, right? In other words, the argument is you have it for defense, so we want to sell it to the Defense Department in order to be protected from foreign invasion. And so they were working on it for several years. The United States, meanwhile, was working, and we actually started the Air Force. And so the Air Force has started, but the Air Force has to decide what they're going to buy. And they have a choice. They can either buy the Wright brothers' plane, which was called the Wright Flyer 3. It was a third improvement on the original. Wright Flyer 3. The other possibility was a balloon, a hydrogen kind of balloon, an airship that was developed by France. And they said, actually, these balloons, these airships are the wave of the future, where you kind of float over there, and that is going to be the wave of the future. And so that was a possibility. And the third possibility was fund again Samuel Langley for a third attempt to do an airplane, because he said he had some technical adjustments that were going to get it right this time. And I have a question for you. The final question here, and we'll open up pretty soon to questions you can ask me. But let me ask you this. I want to take a vote. Do you think they bought the Wright Flyer 3, the balloon, or Langley? They were determined to do one or the other and put that one product into the Air Force. How many of you think the government bought the Wright Flyer 3? This was weird. There was one hand that went like this and then looked around. So we had one person who thought so, but not apparently in an enthusiastic way. No one thinks that. How many thought okay, zero for the Wright Flyer. Is that right? Zero? Let me look around. Okay, one for the two. Yes, I see it. Two, three, four, five, six. Look at that. There's a groundswell. Six. Okay, six votes for the Wright Flyer 3. How many think the balloon? One, two, three, four, five, six. Also six again. Six. How many think they gave Langley another subsidy? Oh my gosh. The majority of you overwhelmingly are saying that they gave Langley the subsidy. I'm happy to report they did not. In fact, one congressman said when they were voting on it, he said, the only thing Langley ever made fly was government money. No, they did not take the Langley subsidy. You people don't trust your government's inventive economic powers. No, enough. They bought the balloon. They bought the balloon. And so the balloon will be the first item into the Air Force's arsenal. Now, the French sold the balloon, but there was something that was so suspicious that even some of the government people got suspicious. The French had sold the balloon, but then they invited the Wright brothers to come over for a flight demonstration. They flew all over Paris, and then the French wanted to order an airplane. And the Defense Department thought, aha, you're not going to fool us. We're going to buy one too. And so the Defense Department did buy a Wright Flyer III, and eventually we had an airplane. That too is going to be invented by the United States, overcoming a failed government subsidy. And we have this explosion in the late 1800s of inventions. Whether it's the greatest in world history is a debatable question, but it's an explosion and an outpouring of inventions culminating with the airplane, transforming technology, travel, military. The 1900s will be the American century because of what that generation, which has could be called the greatest generation in the late 1800s, did under a system of total freedom without government subsidies. And when they did have them, they didn't work. In a system of free enterprise, an outpouring of greatness, and the United States becomes a great economic superpower. Thank you.